I know what you got. I know what you need. I know what you're thinking. All right.
Welcome to Freethinker Radio. That was Devil Killing Moth doing the intro there.
Yep, check them out. They are longtime friends of us and the Houston Freethinkers. Today is Monday, October, what is it, 3rd?
Something like that.
3rd, early October. It's starting to get cool here in Houston. Hope you guys are enjoying the weather. And if you're somewhere else where it's already cold, I hope it's not too crazy. And if you're somewhere where it's still hot, I hope it's like one of those hots that's like really cool. Like you're on the beach and you're hanging out and it's just the wind's blowing in your hair and everything feels great. That kind of thing. Not the blistering, boiling hot type of thing.
Yeah, that's not so great.
So we got another awesome show today. We have a guest coming on later, I think. All right.
Yeah, we have a musical guest coming in the studio from the band Shalva. We'll be playing some of their music as well as other local music. So I hope you can get into that and spread that about. We're not limited to that. We get beyond the local and into the regional and beyond. But we are definitely fueled for local arts and music scene. And we'll be talking about a lot of events and getting into the news here in a minute. So
yeah, I want to mention before we start covering our local events, the one of the things that just happened here in the city of Houston, which is beneficial for all of our community. Myself and a couple of the people in the Houston Freethinkers, who some of you may know, have got a new house that we're going to use for the, as we call it, the Freethinker House, for meetings and documentary screenings, skill shares, have a little space for gardening because it's a house space with a lot of gardening room, big yard all around the house, and the neighbors, everybody's pretty cool. So we plan to do some gardening events there, house shows, open mics, you know, Houston Freethinker style things. So that's going to be really exciting for a lot of us to just have that space, and really want it to be, again, the space that other people in the community can use for their meetings and their events. But overall, it's going to be a good thing. We have this big garage as well that we're just kind of getting cleaned up. Try to use open mics. We also were this morning just talking about some of the events that we discussed at last week's Houston Freethinkers meeting. Thanks again to everybody who came out to that. But we discussed a number of things. There seemed to be an overwhelming interest from the people who came. There was probably about 20 or so people who showed up. This is our first meeting in a few months. An overwhelming interest, as has been for a while, in solutions and skill shares and gardening and self-sufficiency. And this seems to be, for me, it's a trend I've noticed in various activist realms for quite a while. It seems people like are more geared towards wanting those solutions, tired of hearing about all the craziness, only the negativity. You know, on this show here, we try to educate you guys and tell you what's happening in our city, talk about news that pertains to our city nationally and internationally, have guests on to talk about a variety of topics, keep you guys informed, but at the same time remind you that there are a lot of positive things happening and there are steps that you can take in your life to make your life a bit more free and to help those around you. And so we want to promote that, and that seems like more people that are involved with the Houston Freethinkers online and in the physical world are interested in that. So we want the Freethinker House space to be used in that same way for those who are interested. This Sunday afternoon we're going to be having a gardening day come out, and we're just basically going to start working on that whole plot that we have there and see what we can come up with, you know, geared towards permaculture and some of the ideas that we've learned, spent the last 4 or 5 years learning at the last organic outpost, being involved there and working with that community. So it'll be really cool to have that. And we've had some gardens in the past at one of the past Freethinker House, and I think we've grown food at each one just in some way or another. And so that'll be cool to continue. That'll be this Sunday, and in the following Saturday, and we'll remind you guys about this again next week, but the following Saturday, if you're in the city, come check us out at 323 Hutchison. The Freethinker House will be making events for this and throwing a Facebook page and all that stuff so you guys can keep up with what we're doing there and hopefully get involved. But the following Saturday, we'll be having a housewarming party / 6th anniversary, Houston Freethinker anniversary potluck get together. So we hope to see a lot of people who've been involved with the Freethinkers over the years, some new faces, maybe people who've just recently got involved, and also people who maybe never been involved but are curious and after 6 years are ready to say, all right, I'll come check it out. So you'll find out more about that. And I think we do have a Facebook event today. So if you would like to follow along with all the information that we're going to be talking about, the musicians that we play, the events that we list and the articles that we cover, you can go to Freethinker Radio on Facebook page on Facebook and find our event page, which we'll pin to the top of the page. And in there, there's a thread that you can follow. And of course, we try to put the sources, links back to the sources during for the archives, which you can find on the Houston Freethinkers YouTube channel every week after the show.
For sure, for sure. There's lots of reasons we do that, because one, we want you to be able to access all this information. Two, we want you to be able to dig deeper than we're able to cover. And three, all these musicians, artists, and events we cover have a lot more going on than we can make it to. And we'd like this.
There's a lot of awesome stuff happening.
It's a great, wonderful universe to be part of. So, glad you're here with us today.
Can I ask you a question?
No, and you just did, and I feel violated.
Okay, can I ask you another question?
Yes.
What does Mr. Rogers sing?
Last I checked.
Yes, what it just, you know, out of memory, just pull
it's
it out.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood.
Why? 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 What universe are you from? Call
it's
in right now.
His neighborhood only.
713.
It's only his neighborhood and no other neighborhood is it beautiful.
713-526-8737. I want you to call in right now and tell me, what does Mr. Rogers say in his song? Because Micah just said his answer, this, but I swear I remember it, and I think there's others out there remember it always being, it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, the neighborhood, the.
That's just what some
that's
children
what it always
sang.
Was.
I always was wondering what
no,
was
that's
up
what
with
it is.
Kids.
And, okay, so I just, you know, maybe this could be a case of that old Mandela effect. Maybe some of you guys have heard about that. And if you feel like talking about that, call in. We'll maybe get into that later, but it's a whole other can of worms. But I'd like to know, just in our unofficial scientific poll here, how many people remember Mr. Rogers' song as this neighborhood or the neighborhood?
And, I know I sang it as the.
And so I have a way to prove, though, that if it's this, which is apparently right now, this is the truth, is apparently if you look it up, it's this. And it's,
yeah, and if you're cool, you say it's this.
It's always been this. But I remember it as the neighborhood, and I have a way to prove this, okay, because there's this cartoon, this children's cartoon called Daniel Tiger. Now, some of y'all may remember Daniel Tiger was one of the little puppets that Mr. Rogers played with. Well, they made a cartoon about Daniel Tiger's life, and it has a lot of the same characters from Mr. Rogers, and it has the exact same song as the theme song. But in
not
that
the
song,
exact.
They say the neighborhood,
not the
original,
exact.
The original.
They
have the
poetic
have the
license,
real original version,
level.
And that's something. There's like a glitch in the Matrix, and
they're like in a glitch in the Matrix, man. You're
maybe
stuck
I'm
in
a
glitch.
All right, call in 713-526-8737 if you have
a glitch
anything,
in the Matrix.
If you've been glitched in the Matrix and you remember it being the neighborhood, call in and let us know. But for now, we're going to, I guess, get into some local events.
Yeah, sounds good. Sounds good. And, of course, as we've mentioned before, there is the event today. If you go in on Facebook, of course, like Freethinker Radio, KPFT, et cetera. But if you type in Freethinker Radio with Shalva Live, you should see it. It's also going to be posted on the page. And all the events we speak about rather rapidly will show up in there so you can dig a little deeper. So let's get going. Event blast, I guess this is. So tonight, our friends in Texture Yellow, Alicia Dyeringer and friends, along with El Lago, Space City, Mod Club, Luke Sweeney and others, will be at Walters. And so that should be pretty good, getting going around 8 o'clock. And also, I've been seeing this one, but I don't know where it is because I don't know where it is. But yeah, this is a Goodbye June with Devil Killing Moth. Nice. Doors at 7, and it's free entry Tuesday, October 4th. So tomorrow night, you know, something to get into. If you know where it is, let us know.
There's also one thing I'll throw out that I know for sure. I haven't even looked, but I know this is every Monday typically, or every, I can't remember. It's one of the Mondays. Maybe it's the first Monday. That would make sense. But the Free Radicals are playing free show tonight at Avant Garden.
Nice.
So
nice.
You go there, hang out.
Yeah, definitely. There's something you may have seen, these white bikes around town, the ghost bikes as they're called, in honor of fallen cyclists. There's a placement tomorrow from 7 to 8, West 43rd and Sue Burnett, for in honor of Marvin Rucker. Let's see what else we got to get into. Our friend Dylan Trim, you may have heard him here on Freethinker Radio or anywhere that rocks, because he's going to be rocking Satellite Bar, it turns out, tomorrow night as well. Busy night, you know, Tuesday, and this is an all-ages show, so, you know, if you haven't been able to get into some of these bars, don't let the beer bar stop you from enjoying good music. Get out to this, and it'll be a good time. Here's another kind of, if you're into I've always liked things they do at this little museum here in Montrose. It's a printing museum.
Yeah, they have cool stuff there.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. They've done quite a few things, ZineFest and more. But so if you're familiar with it or if you're not, you might want to get into it. It's over on West Clay. But they're having a hand paper making and printing with pulp class, basically. It's, you know, you basically pay for your materials and can get into learning all sorts of things. And they've got a big about part that I can't read all these abouts to tell you about. But if you're into that, get into it. Find out what it's all about.
We're making paper, basically. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, yeah, making paper by hand. So that might be a useful skill, you know.
That's a pretty cool skill.
Heck yeah. Hell yeah. So, yeah, that rounds out Tuesday. See how busy it is? It's a great and wonderful place to be. Wednesday at 8, Shrey Day. We've played him here along with Pluto, who will be at For the Community, Moody Black, Chief, and the Doomsday Device, nice name. And Ghost Palace Doomsday. Will be playing an all-ages show, $8 over at Satellite Bar. And also, on Thursday, another thing to get into, all-ages show, October 6th. Autonana Trio, Shalva, who we'll be speaking to today, probably bringing up this show, The Field Trip, very progressive, heavy mix of genres that's really starting to come in their own. They played For the Community in the past, and looks like they're going to be in this one, as well as Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchists. So that's at Natsuo Thursday night, so go ahead and put a little star on that calendar for that, you know. Because Otanana Trio is coming in from Japan, and they're always fun. Let's see what else is going on. I saw this.
I got a couple.
Yeah,
here.
Yeah.
And we're going to be posting all these events too. I just started that thread in the Facebook event. If you want to follow along, the Voodoo Glow Skulls. Did you say that one already?
Not yet.
They're playing tomorrow night at White Oak Music Hall, and they're a pretty cool band. But also a couple bands that are connected to our community, and specifically Metanoia, who's been on the show. Christina has been on the show, and they've played a lot of our shows, and they're playing For the Community. They're playing this show, so if you want to see them play with Always Guilty and the Voodoo Glow Skulls, check them out. That should
that
be a fun show.
Cool.
That's happening tomorrow. Then also, there's a couple other events happening on Friday and Saturday that I want to tell you about real quick. One of them is called Why and What Pipelines Leak, and it's basically a Q&A with specialists in the field on oil and gas, break down the science of why pipelines leak and what they leak. There's going to be a couple different people, like I said, in that field specifically talking about that. And that's Friday. We're going to have that at Midtown Bar and Grill upstairs Friday night. I believe that's, let me see, 7:30. And, that should be good. That's being hosted by Houston Stand to Standing Rock. Oh, and I do want to say that this weekend there was also that benefit show for the Houston Stand to Standing Rock. Friday afternoon or Friday night at Natsuo. Thank you to everybody who came out and to everybody who supported. Myself and Oscar got to go up on stage a little bit and talk about what we're doing locally, both Houston Freethinkers and this, you know, helping start this new group focused on that issue. And we collected a good amount of donations. I don't know what the final count was that Oscar got, but people were handing cash throughout the night, and then we got at least one blanket started for our collection of donations. And I think the plan is to head back to North Dakota on October 21st for a week, and to bring what we can. It's probably going to be, you know, now there's been two different caravans of people we've known that have gone from Houston, and this time there's probably going to be a couple of cars, about seven people going back. So, yeah, if you want to get involved with that, check out Houston Stands of Standing Rock. And once again, thank you to everybody who showed up.
How was the show?
I mean, it was awesome. The music was great. The bands are always great. Carmacy is good. And Ganesha, of course, they did good. Vox Vosis. They all played great sets, and it was a good turnout. And there was support there for sure. I got to talk to some people this lady who is a local photographer, and she said she wanted to support in some different ways, like come document any events we did and stuff, so that was kind of cool.
Did the people who came to the show learn more about what's going on up there?
I think so. There was, when I asked as far as were people familiar with it, there did seem to be like a general awareness, and that's probably just because things like social media, people see a lot of memes or just videos getting shared pretty widely, so even though it hasn't really been covered by the mainstream media, so to speak, it's been shared pretty well on social media, so I think people are aware of it in that way. So that was cool to at least have a few people who said, oh hey, we appreciate what you guys had to say. Like, you know, I think more people will look into it. And there's two more events I want to tell you guys about, and then I'll throw it back to you, Micah. This Sunday is, I guess it's, I don't know if it's actually Sunday or Monday, but it's going to be Columbus Day, and what some people are alternatively have been trying for years to get called Indigenous Peoples Day, or you know, some people call it Decolonization Day. But in Houston, I Don't Know More Houston is hosting a third annual Decolonization Day Indigenous Survivors of Genocide, Slavery, and Colonization March. Join us for the third annual Indigenous Peoples March in Houston. Call out to elders, pipe carriers, traditional dancers, hand drum, powwow singers, families, allies, supporters, in or out of traditional regalia, ready to share space and discuss what decolonization looks like for each of us representing the people, various colors of the earth. Stand up in solidarity with all our relatives and for our right to clean and plentiful natural resources. So it says, let's come together for our First Nations of Texas. And they are going to, I think they're going to march. I'm trying to get it. Okay, so it says Sunday, October 9th, 10 a.m., gather with signs, drums, rattles to rally and begin marching at 10:30 a.m. to Bell Park. Meet and rally at the corner of Benz and Bissonnette in front of the Contemporary Arts Museum, Houston Sculpture Garden. We'll be drumming, singing, dancing, smudging, and then peacefully walking to the park at 4800 Montrose, where an offensive Christopher Columbus statue exists. So they'll be marching to the statue of Christopher Columbus. And 10:30, 10:45, 11, walk north. Yeah, so they have a schedule here, and I'll post that event if you want to check that out. And you can see more about that on the I Don't Know More Houston page. So check that out if you'd like to. And that will be that was Sunday. And then there's another event that I'm actually going to be speaking at this weekend, a part of it. But even besides that, it seems like a pretty cool event if you're into these kind of things, meditation, yoga, organic food, you know, that type of setting. And there's going to be a bunch of different speakers, myself included, talking on a variety of topics, from like, you know, yoga practitioners and people talking about communication building, talking about consciousness, and a mix of topics. And then there's going to be massage therapists there, yoga, like a bunch of different types of people who are offering things like that, and meditations a couple times a day. And it's just an all-day Saturday event, and there's going to be food and all that good stuff. And you can check that out. It's called the Metamorphosis Fall Retreat. And yeah, I'll be speaking there Saturday at 4 o'clock. You can check that out. Those events have been posted now in the Freethinker Radio Facebook event for this week.
All right. Yeah, definitely. And if you're into any of those things and you want to take your friends, you might just take a moment to invite a few of them. It always goes further to spread the ideas, you know, whether it's papermaking or a act you enjoy or whatever it may be, a protest or a benefit or anything. That goes a long way, especially with the limitations that Facebook is putting on being used to be media socially amongst your friends and things. Very, very frustrating. But anyway, I wanted to get on a little bit with these events. Like, there's one coming up. Also, I was going to say before the old Nana Trio show, you can get into Autumn Falls. It's a art show over at Babolo Gallery at from 6 to 9. Just a few more, and then we'll wind this up. Goodness. First Ward historic meeting. Going to talk all about the history of First Ward. You can get into that. Forever Today will be making a radio appearance in College Station. And if you're in College Station and involved with the bands there, you should find us. Also, so check out KNM Friday from 12 to 1 and hear our friends Forever Today who have been here before. Also, Friday night, there's a punk show over at White Swan. That's always nice, right? Got Daggerhead, The Cops, Zero Heroes, and Screech of Death. And so that should be pretty good. Yeah. Got some members in some of those bands that are in other bands, if you know what I'm saying. Houston Weird Homes Tour. I don't know if I'll be able to go on that, but that looks pretty cool.
Weird Homes?
Yeah, get to go with all these weird homes. Looks pretty good. It says tickets available, and that might be an impediment. It's a fundraiser, though, so maybe I don't feel so bad about spending money.
I'm into weird homes.
Yeah, you know, and Houston has a few. Not just, you know, but a few.
A few.
Yep. Conversations with artist William Cannings at Anya Tisch Gallery, The Dirty Seeds out at Acadia on Saturday, and Paul Oakenfold, if you're out in Austin, 3-hour extended set at Kingdom. What's up that? Saturday night.
3 hours. Yep. That's a hell of a set.
Yep. And that's all I got for events.
All right. Well, we're going to cut to some local news now, and we're going to start off with something that you should probably be concerned with. So let's just check this out real quick here.
weird trend that's happening across the country. Clowns threat, and it's happening on social media. The latest target is Spring ISD.
Yeah, Lauren Tallarico joins us now from the district headquarters to explain. Lauren, these clowns are certainly no laughing matter.
Yeah, you said it. Certainly, there's nothing funny about this. Today, Spring ISD will have extra security at several of their campuses because of yet another spooky clown threat made online. There are several of these online spooky clown social media accounts set up out there. Now, the district posted this message to their Facebook page, letting parents know that these threats are just a hoax. But even so, they have stepped up security today. And about 100 miles east of us, so over in Port Arthur, that ISD district is also dealing with similar threats today. One of the first spooky clown sightings was spotted back in August in South Carolina, and since then, there have been several other sightings or online posts threatening kids and schools in various states. In fact, hey, just this past Friday, we let you know about this one. HISD and Humble ISD sent letters to parents, and Bay City ISD went into lockdown because of these clown threats. It has local police all across the country and even Homeland Security looking into these threats. But today, all Spring ISD campuses will be open. The district says they have determined this is just a hoax, but even so, they will.
Okay, that's enough. All right.
There are no scary clowns. This is just a hoax. Just a hoax. Sure, sure.
Sure, there's nothing to worry about here. I mean, but seriously, I mean, I was kind of just played that as a joke, but seriously, have you guys heard about this? These clowns?
Sounds like a lot of money's being spent.
Call in if you've seen a clown recently and you have a story to share. 713-526-8737.
What about McDonald's? That's a scary clown.
Ronald?
Yeah.
He is a scary clown.
I always wonder why they had to, like, try to give you
I guess,
food
what is it about clowns that's scary? Is it just, like, the only place that they're supposed to be?
I don't think it's scary as much as creepy.
Like, the only place that it's safe to see a clown is if there's a child's birthday party going on. Any other context,
or
it's
rodeo.
Like, why are you wearing a clown costume? Or a circus, yeah, or a clown. Like
rodeo.
Okay, so those are the only situations where society has decided it's acceptable
boundaries,
to be
you know?
A clown. Beyond that, you are not welcome.
Yeah, pretty much.
All right, well, I guess I'll have to accept that. I was going to be a clown for Halloween, but I'm worried that I might end up getting beat up.
It sounds pretty hostile out there for the clowns.
Yeah, there's clown lives matter.
That they do. But yeah, it's been a growing story. I've wondered about it, you know. I've wondered what's going on. And they do say that clown costumes being sold for Halloween are outpacing other Halloween costumes. So here in 2016, the classic clown is the number one Halloween selling costume right now.
Are you serious?
So there's going to be clowns on the streets everywhere, creeping people out, creeping, spooking. What else do clowns do when they're not in their cages? Call in, let us know. Have you seen a clown doing something other than being chased by bulls at the rodeo, popping out of car with about 18 million other clowns, or any other clown-appropriate activities other than McDonald's? We're really onto that guy, onto that clown.
Okay, I'm gonna let that one go.
All right. Got it.
So this Houston traffic taxi driver, he's been accused of illegally smuggling
clowns,
immigrants.
Oh.
Not clowns. Jim, a Houston taxi driver is accused of smuggling illegal immigrants, authorities said. Jim Wells County Sheriff deputies stopped a taxi driven by Jesse Fulmer about 200 miles away from Houston, and they
you can't drive illegal
took him
immigrants?
On foot.
Oh, smuggle them. Okay,
they're
sorry.
Saying he may be smuggling. I guess that's what you do. If a person becomes...
I'm not smuggling them. I'm driving them.
If the person becomes illegal and then you put them in your car and you transport, now you're transporting a quote-unquote illegal human being and you are a trafficker. Two people were held...
trafficking. Mm-hmm.
Texas driver Jesse Fulmer is facing a felony charge of smuggling of persons is being held on $10,000 bail. Smuggling a person of persons.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I think that everybody should have the freedom to be smuggled if they choose to be smuggled.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I really just don't know much about that. It seems like they really want to put these boundaries up and charge you to get in.
Well, that's how I felt recently when I had to get my passport. I felt like, you know, okay, I can understand this. And, you know, in any sort of truly free society, people might decide, hey, we want to have
private party.
Yeah, some way to tell where people are coming from and you make sure you get all the... proper shots or just different things like that could still exist in a different world from the one we're in now. But still, just some part of me felt like this feels like a permission slip to like leave this line and to walk across it, you know what I mean, or to go somewhere else. And that was a weird feeling.
For sure, for sure. Got a lot of local headlines as usual. The beatdowns don't seem so bad, at least the reported beatdowns are kind of, you know, on a lull. But the murder rate's up, so I don't know what's up with that. Anyway, you know.
Did anybody go to that White Lives Matter protest this weekend? Anybody out there? Houston had a White Lives Matter group coming to the Anti-Defamation League to protest them because the Anti-Defamation League is labeled the White Lives Matter. I don't even want to say it's a movement because I did some research last week before they came to Houston, and it's like I found a YouTube channel that has like no followers and maybe 10 views, a Facebook page that's equally small, and maybe it seems like a handful of people who don't even really live in Houston but are coming from other places, and it seems like they're kind of scattered throughout the U.S. Not to say that there isn't people who have based on what these people say, I know there's the assumption to say, oh, people say White Lives Matter, they must be racist or something. But based just on what this dude in the video who was promoting the event that I saw under the White Lives Matter channel said, he kept repeating, and of course, yeah, anyway, this is could be cover for whatever. But based on his words, he said, you know, we want to make it clear that we are not racist, that we're just trying to protest the Anti-Defamation League for, you know, basically saying that our White Lives Matter movement, which is trying to raise awareness that statistics say that white people have been killed more often than black people in 2016 or something like that, that he wants to have this White Lives Matter movement. So they're claiming to not be racist, you know, and they went out there, though, and tons of people, including Houston Black Lives Matter and the Houston Socialist group. There's a bunch of different groups that I know kind of came together and came out there on Saturday and were waving signs that said stop racism, smash fascist, just different, a variety of groups. And the White Lives Matter activists apparently had signs that said stop killing our police officers and waved images of Pepe the Frog, which some of you guys may know from the memes going around the internet and has recently been declared a hate symbol by the Anti-Defamation League. This is also sort of a symbol.
I don't even really know what this is now.
It's just this whole other thing, and Hillary Clinton brought attention to it, but honestly, it is somewhat associated with people who tend to be kind of like super conservative and borderline racist, if not outright racist. What is becoming more and more known as the alt-right uses Pepe the Frog, this green frog, in different ways, and so it has come to be known associated with these groups who maybe have racist attitudes, but the symbol itself is just a symbol, and just like anything, it could mean anything, you know?
Yeah.
So that's silly, and so they were out there, I guess, kind of protesting this. So you have two different groups having different, you know, perspectives here. The leader, apparently, that's at least what the Chronicle's calling him, Ken Reed, was wearing a Donald Trump hat, and he said, "This isn't about Nazism, we are here because white lives matter." Self-proclaimed pro-white activists originally planned the event to protest the civil rights organization, which they called disgustingly anti-American. They're calling us a hate group, the Post said online. And this brought together students from Democratic Society to Black Lives Matter and a bunch of other groups together to stand out against them. And, of course, the counter-protesters way outnumbered them, 50-plus people there. And Ashton Woods, who we've worked with on some actions, including the recent Houston Stands of Standing Rock actions, he said, "We're here to drown the voices of the White Lives Matter white supremacists out. They're out here protesting the ADL, but it's more than that. They're white supremacists. They no longer matter. They never did. It's time for their voices to be drowned out." So, yeah, interesting stuff happening here in Houston. And honestly, it was, you know, I was busy moving that day, but at the same time, I thought about going. I was like, oh, that's happening. I remember that. But I also remember thinking earlier in the week about, and I think I may have talked about this, like, I sometimes get in these ideas where I'm like, oh, I want to do a video or a rant or a Facebook post about this or something, like social media post about, oh, the debates or, you know, these crazy people coming to town or whatever. But then in the end, I find myself being like, you know what, it's just a waste of energy even to, like, feed into this. Like, I don't want to do a rant telling people about the debates. I'd rather just not talk about the debates. And on one hand, it's like you're missing out on an audience, right? But because you're not speaking to the mass of people who are going to pay attention to the debate, and maybe by talking about the debate and getting them to see newer ideas about it, you could reach them. But at the same, you know, and so I think there's value in that. But at the same time, I find myself leaning more towards, like, don't even give these things energy, you know. And that's kind of how I feel with this negativity coming to Houston is like, yeah, I do think that there is a certain level where, you know, dangerous mentalities coming should be confronted, you know, with, you know, if they can have freedom of speech, but definitely people, if there's violent and aggressive, dangerous ideas towards human life, then those ideas should be confronted, you know, if they're going to be allowed to exist. And it seems like that's what a free society would allow, is any idea to exist. So it's a complicated situation, but I decided not to even go there and spend my energy.
You know, sometimes you were naming like some of the different groups, and I'm like, kind of like, yeah, I guess I'm glad I wasn't there. You know, it sounds like a mixed bag of everything, you know, as far as what's the purpose. You know, it's just everybody's like, these people are bad, these people are bad, these people are bad, pointing each other in a triangle, you know, and I'm like, okay, whatever. I'm over here. I'm very, you know, going to read what you post and see what happens. But I don't think I have to go there and make a decision with that there on that one, at least. But that was just me, you know, and that's a great thing, you know, is like people can pay attention to something and not form a judgment about it and keep getting facts on it. Or, you know, they can also go to things that they're impassioned about and stand up for them. So props to those people that did that. And, you know, props to the people that bother to even think about this stuff. We do live in crazy, crazy times. And sometimes I'm just amazed at the stuff that's going on. The video, turns out Metro Police released a video of beating that one guy down. It's kind of...
Oh, the one we were talking about a couple weeks ago?
Yeah, just, just recently.
Is this a different one?
We talked about him here. Okay. We've talked about so many beatdowns. I lose track of them all. But this is the beatdown of... What was the individual's name here?
Oh, the officers were fired, right? Or were they?
He managed to resign right before he was terminated. You know, they get this ability to resign before they're terminated. I just don't always understand that one, you know. And they're looking into if they're going to, you know, file charges or whatever. It turns out there are about 200 Metro police officers. They claim their excessive force cases are rare. I don't know. You tell us, call in if you've got excessive force from a Metro police officer. That's the thing. You know, we have so many different police officers. The thing about this is this is daylight, and the guy is kind of pushing a little bit, but they just commenced.
Is it? I mean, I didn't
hit him more than two dozen times.
It's a beating, I guess.
Yeah. With the little thin baton, you know.
I want to use words when I see those videos. When I want to use words that the FCC won't allow me to say on the radio.
Yeah, well, you can get further into that because I wasn't even going to really bring it up here because we did cover it initially, but I thought it was interesting that they did release it.
Yeah, and it's a good update, I think.
And follow through with it. It's another case where, you know, the individual is able to resign without being terminated. Turns out Harris County is hiring yet another legal law firm to continue to fight the bail reform lawsuit that claims, which is another story we've been following here, which claims, you know, that our bail system in Harris County, you know, basically is unjust to the poorest, the poor, middle class, et cetera, and those who cannot afford, you know, bonds and bail. So you can get further into that. It was all initiated on a lawsuit filed on the name of Miranda O'Donnell, the single mother who spent 2 days in jail after being arrested for driving without a license because she couldn't post a $2,500 bail. Yeah, and the new law firm, they're going to be paying $169,000, $169,464. That's growing by the hour. I think it's $610 an hour. Those two stories are local. Got tons of things going on.
Well, before we go, I'm going to throw in a song, and we'll break this up a little bit with some more music here, and we'll come back. Are we still on local? Are we breaking the state, national?
We can just move around. I got a couple other good local things, and then we'll just move on.
There really is. It's been a big week, and you know, we won't talk about the election, but the election gets closer, and the reason I mention it without talking about the actual people involved, because they're irrelevant, and so are their debates, is, you know, there's some efforts to expose these people coming from a bunch of different fronts, and there's a really interesting story that I want to get into in just a bit regarding WikiLeaks trying to release information related to Hillary Clinton, and then supposedly having to delay that because of some threats to Julian Assange's life. So lots of interesting things going on, and I'd love to hear you guys' opinion on there, because there's some people talk about this idea of the Clinton body count, you know, looking back that you can trace people who have mysterious deaths around the Clintons and
just falling out,
just, you know, having some accidents or random robberies. So there's some interesting ideas and things to get into. We're going to unpack all that in just a little bit, but right now we're going to give you some, and I hope you guys can handle this, I'll start it slow and quiet, so if you can't, then you can just keep it low. But this is Blackie, all caps with spaces, here from here in Houston, Texas, and he is going to be one of our headlining closing artists of for the community 12 on November 12th. He played number 11, I think it was, yeah, he played last time, and he's coming back. So yeah, he'll be putting on another just awesome show. And if you've never seen him live, like, I think that his music that you're about to hear, it's interesting. It's some of it's definitely you can get into it, but also I think he's a live performer because he's just all over the place, and he's known for building his own speakers and bringing them in and basically just having stacks of speakers blasting you in the face with this. So check this out. This is from Blackie, from his album from 2014, or his EP, Imagine Yourself in a Free and Natural World. This song is called Cry Pig.
to death, death to death. Ready yet? No, the trap is set, the trap is set. I never left, I never left. Misdirect, misdirect, misdirect. Death to death, death to death. Skeleton steps, skeleton steps. Death to death, death to death. I never left, I resurrect.
Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. My name is Derek Bros, and I'm here with Micah Jackson.
For sure, Blackie. For the Community 12, we'll be talking a lot more about that, but
that November was called Cry 12. Pig.
Cry Pig.
Interpret it how you will.
Yeah.
Cry Pig.
Oh, got a few headlines I'll hit, and so we can just, we've been having so many things go on, we just got to cover a lot of information. Around 4, we'll have our guest in the studio here. Temple police took 2 days to alert public about a reported abduction attempts of like an 8-year-old boy. So, yeah, if they knew, they'd let you know. So, you know, always keep that in mind. If they knew something dangerous was going to happen to your children or something, they'd let you know. But anyway, moving on beyond that.
You expect me to believe that?
I kind of like this one. The school board president, we covered this originally, the students kneeling during anthem, the school board president's defending them.
Were they suspended?
Nope, they are being defended.
So this is a school of football players or something?
Dallas. It looks like volleyball, basketball.
Oh, damn, they got a bunch.
Yeah, they got a few different things. And
the whole athletic department took a knee.
Yeah, pretty much. And then all these stories will be posted in there. I got a couple others on the local, and then we'll move on. Yep. Former South Houston councilman pleads guilty to bribery. City of South Houston, if you're all familiar with that. Councilman Garcia. And let's see. Harris County, this might be one of the more pressing local stories. Covered both in the Chronicle, Houston Press, and elsewhere. Harris County Sheriff may hand over 17-year-olds to private prison contractor.
Say what?
Yeah, get all into that, because after failing to comply with Prison Rape Elimination Act standards, basically the law, after breaking the law, they just don't read it like that, you know what I'm saying?
What is the law?
After failing to comply with Prison Rape Elimination Act standards requiring that 17-year-olds be separated from adults in the Harris County Jail, Harris County Sheriff's Office is drafting plans to send the teens off to Limestone County, roughly 3 hours away from their families and, you know, benefiting a private prison contractor. And also the flood control district's going to be using drones.
Say.
Yeah. Now, and I guess I can hit this and make it semi-local. As if you didn't know that it was rough enough with ISD police, some ISDs here in Texas have police and guards. That's right.
Like in prison?
Yeah, like in prison. Not only does it seem like in prison, but it is like in prison. This girl got thrown to the ground.
Let's just take the like out of there.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, they're trying to remove the pipeline, so it's not a school-to-prison pipeline, just a prison.
Just no pipeline, just prison.
Yeah. So you can get into all those stories there in the event for today. So
who are we talking to today at 4?
We're going to talk to one of the members of Shalva. I'm not exactly sure which one, though.
So, okay, cool. Well, I guess
they're going to come in. Originally, they were just going to call and talk about what they got going on, but they're going to come in and play a little bit of acoustic music, and that'll be that.
Cool. Well, I got a couple of stories that I'll cover until then. One is, I think, really, while we look into the national stage, is probably one of the bigger ones that just happened in the last week, and that is that the U.S. Congress did actually override President Obama's veto of the 9/11 Saudi bill, the bill related to the lawsuit against the 9/11, or from the 9/11 family members against Saudi Arabia, excuse me. And yeah, we told you last week that Obama had threatened to veto it. He did end up vetoing it after it was unanimously passed in the Senate and in the House, because some of these people probably did do it for political reasons, because they don't want to look bad vetoing, you know, the 9/11 family members. They probably don't really care about justice or getting more truth related to the 9/11 attacks. But that's where we come in, right? And that's where the so-called 9/11 truth movement has been for the last 15 years, basically questioning the narrative. I went to New York last month for 9/11, and I wrote an article for Mint Press News. I'll post that in the link, because I think that's probably something you might want to read, just for where that whole movement is itself. But in the more mainstream world, with this law, it's known as JASTA, Justice Against State Terrorism Act, and basically it's now officially became law because Congress overrode President Obama's veto. And so as of last week, it became legal now for the first time for victims of terrorism to sue nations that are suspected of financing terrorism, where in the past, up until last week, it was basically only countries that are on the state sponsors list, which we talked about last week as well, like Iran, North Korea, other people that are the enemies, right?
Can but, I sue the United States to get my rights
reinstated? You might be able to now, and this is the thing. This is why that this is opening up this whole can of worms, which really, I'll be honest, I didn't think it was even going to get this far, because it's like, oh, they're never going to let that happen, right? And there really is a lot of resistance. So first, the bill passes because they override him, right? That means, okay, it's law now. You can, these 9/11 families, after 15 years, can now sue Saudi Arabia. 15 of the 19 alleged hijackers who were involved with that attack, allegedly involved with that attack, come from Saudi Arabia. There's also financial connections, but there's also connections to, from Pakistan, and some would say Israel, and others say suspect even the United States itself. So technically, these families now can sue different nations. And the way the world works, the way that these statist organizations work, this is really, it's the truth, is that these people, they come together, they declare themselves a government or a state, and they declare a monopoly on a certain landmass, right? And then they, once they see other states, okay, those warriors kind of got strong enough now, I'll respect their claim to that area, right? Then they partner up together, and they say, okay, well, we're going to have something called diplomatic immunity, which basically means, as we build our little empire and we work together to do it, when you do things wrong, we won't sue, allow, you know, anything to happen to your diplomats or your people, and the same goes for us. So they are partnered together. And so the United States has diplomatic immunity. That's why Henry Kissinger, who's suspected for war crimes, can travel around the world, and when people try to serve warrants on him, they're sort of laughed at, and you know, he continues to walk around in this day because he has diplomatic immunity. So Saudi Arabia and other nations that are suspected of terrorism, like the United States, are, you know, immune to these lawsuits. But guess what? Even just in the last couple of days, it's already happening. Two big developments. The 9/11, one 9/11 widow has already sued, this filed a lawsuit against Saudi Arabia just since this happened, like on Friday. Friday is when the over, or last Wednesday was when they overrid the veto, and now she, as soon as Friday, she filed a lawsuit. The wife and daughter of a Navy commander killed on 9/11. And she says the lawsuit claims Al-Qaeda's ability to conduct large-scale terrorist attacks was a direct result of supporting the support Al-Qaeda received from its material sponsors and supporters, including the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Now, of course, this all assumes, like, the mainstream, you know, narrative of 9/11, that Al-Qaeda acted alone, and, you know, Osama bin Laden, etc. But I think it's important to support these kind of things, because the sooner that people start questioning 9/11 and realize, oh, we were lied and we were told it was just Al-Qaeda, now it looks like there's other people involved, that begins the beginning of questioning the larger narrative. So already a 9/11 lawsuit has been filed. And then check this out. This is just reported today, according to a news report in Al Arabiya News, the lobbyist group Arab Project in Iraq is now going to file a lawsuit against the United States for the invasion of Iraq in 2003. The group is pushing for a, quote, full-fledged investigation over the killing of civilians, targets, loss of properties, and individuals who suffered torture or other mistreatment at the hands of the United States. And this is what the United States is worried about. And, I mean, this is not, there's no even, like, conspiracy to it. President Obama straight up said, although the mainstream doesn't really help the average person understand how, you know, ridiculous it is, this answer, they just kind of brush it off. But he says, this is a dangerous precedent. This is a huge mistake. We're, it's going to put our diplomats at risk. And he's, what he's really saying is, we've done some horrible things in the world, and we can't be held accountable for that. If we start going after other nations, they're going to look at us, and they're going to hold, you know, they've said we could easily see different United States officials and generals and military professionals being put in harm's way or being held accountable for different things that they're ordered to do. So maybe this will be lead to some actual accountability. I mean, I don't know. But overall, it's an interesting development to see how it's coming along now as the 9/11 family members continue to seek true justice. And I do want to say the Saudi government did respond to Jasta and the passing of it. Saudi Information Minister, doesn't that sound nice? Information Minister. Adel Al-Tarafi, he said that weakening the sovereign immunity will affect all countries, including the United States. The cabinet expressed hope that wisdom will prevail and that the U.S. Congress would take the necessary steps to avoid the bad and dangerous consequences that may result from the JASTA legislation. And they haven't recently said any specific threats on what they mean or what they're going to do, but the Saudis have in the past said that they would like liquidate tons of U.S. assets and mess with the value of the dollar by trying to dump a bunch of U.S. dollars and assets. So interesting development there, right? But my whole point to bring that up is to say that the world is not telling the truth. Most of the people in the mainstream, quote mainstream, what I like to call the dead stream, they are not telling the truth about what's happening related to 9/11 and tons of other issues. And it's important for you to have a critical mind, to be a skeptical, free thinker, and to pursue answers on your own. And that doesn't mean just agree with every crazy YouTube video out there, because believe me, if you go down this 9/11 rabbit hole, even just dip your toe in that pool, there's a lot of crazy out there. But there are also a lot of very intelligent, passionate, dedicated people, family members, firefighters, architects, engineers, scientists, professionals of all kinds who are working on this issue and really looking for some answers. So I hope that you guys will look more into that topic and see what truth you can find for yourself. And hopefully these lawsuits going forth will lead to some type of justice. You know, obviously the United States and anyone who's involved, they aren't going to come out and just declare that, oops, we did it, you guys can come get us and hold us accountable, we did it, my bad. No, in fact, we're going to have to push for something that is people driven, that is really going to find the truth. And it's not going to come through these systems, it's not going to come through the government. The government won't investigate themselves. They've proven that time and time again. The government, the U.S. government, has been involved in, I'm going to list a bunch of things, look these up: Operation Condor, Ajax, Gladio, Operation Northwoods, tons of other operations that involve either plans or discussions of using what are known as false flag events to trick the people, to scare the people into fear and paranoia. Also look up Operation Mockingbird, the CIA partnering with press agencies to push narratives. I mean, you got to look for truth if you want to find it, and you got to dig through the BS and the propaganda. So I hope you guys will do that. We're going to go to a song, and then when we come back, we'll be on with our guest for the day. So stay tuned. You are listening to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. This is going to be a jam from Whalebones. Check it out. Be right back.
Always in every place to dance, you know you want.
very quickly. Hello, hello, hello. Welcome back to Freethinker Radio. I know you never left, but I always like to say something when we just come in. Well, we have our guest that we promised you, Connor from Shalva. Am I saying that correctly? Shalva?
That is correct. Hello.
Nice, nice. Well, we're glad you're here. And, I'm really maxing out on this. Well, I definitely appreciate everyone that's been tuning in and liking some of the music that we've been playing earlier today. It was Devil Killing Moth. We played some Blackie, All Caps, No Spaces, other For the Community artists. And if you're interested in coming in or having your band played on our show or any of the other KPFT shows, go ahead and hit us up with a message to our page or the Visionary Noise page, and we'd love to hear from you. So welcome, Connor. Glad you're here.
Glad to be here.
Great, great. It's a beautiful day, too, isn't it?
It is.
I've been enjoying that. You know, anytime it isn't 95 or 105 here, I'm just in a better mood.
Yeah, it's been a nice, cool week.
Yeah, yeah. So tell us a little bit about yourself and, you know, the and Shalva and kind of how you came to music, or, you know, just whatever history you'd like to share with us so we can, you know, kind of frame you a bit.
Yeah. Sure. Well, Shalva we're fairly new band in Houston. We formed back in, I believe it was February. I had known the bassist, Connor Nelson, a few months prior to that. But then in February, we found a drummer and we were able to start, you know, rehearsing as a band, writing songs, learning songs. We ended up playing one show. And then in March, and then we had to let go of that drummer. Went a couple months, drummerless, tried out 4 or 5 different drummers, and then stumbled upon our new guy, whose name is Travis. And the last 3-4 months, we've really been just working hard at it, rehearsing. We started off just to kind of warm into it. We played like 4 open mics in July. And now August, September, now October, we've been consistently playing shows pretty much every week here in Houston. We're probably oversaturating it for sure.
Well, you know, a lot of bands, especially when they're new and building up, you know, the listener base, getting the songs out there, they tend to do that. And I think the only thing is moving it around, you know, and picking up the new friends at each show. If you're getting offered shows and you're not exhausted by it yet, then it's probably, you know, beneficial. So that's all pretty exciting. I enjoyed your music online that I was able to hear. You have a real unique sound. Is that sound still pretty much the same? I don't know. I don't want to really nail it down to anything because you're such a new band. Bands evolve, you know, and you were talking about going through drummers, you know, and many bands here in Houston have to go through different members until they, you know, get a certain formula that runs for a while, you know. And, it, you know, there's a feeling sometimes that, oh, we just lost our drummer. Well, you know, yeah, you have that initial darn, now what are we going to do? But then once it's going again and it's tighter and more correct, it's always the only thing that could have happened, right? You know, often.
Yeah, and then, you know, anytime you encounter some sort of obstacle and then are able to overcome it, it's really, you know, fulfilling and inspiring, really.
And and that probably also puts the group of people that have done that, like in something like a group project as a band is, you know, probably a little bit tighter together as friends. Because, you know, look, we made it through that. We've done this. We've done that. You know, and the list gets longer and longer. And it's just like, okay, you know, and that's pretty cool. I see you brought your acoustic guitar. And I've been promising people that we're going to have some live music today. So maybe we could get into something when you're comfortable. And then we can come back and talk a little bit more about the band and maybe what you hope to accomplish with it, or and what's coming up next and where they can find you.
Sure, sounds great.
Cool. All right, well, y'all know how it goes, so bear with us while we get all this sound checking going on, because you know, that's the fastest way to get you to the music. And again, thanks for listening to KPFT and to Freethinker Radio. If you haven't already and you enjoy this set, please go ahead and like the Shalva page, if you're on Facebook, etc. So, let me stop talking.
So maybe you can, like, just give us, like, the range so I can see that we can narrow it down, and then it won't take so much, like, I don't know if you're going to... Like,
sure.
Some vocal test,
yeah,
type stuff.
Test.
Yeah, still no sound check type thing.
just hide behind. Hold on to pain and the fear will stay. That has become my way.
How's that?
That's pretty good. I'm enjoying it.
Cool.
I was like, he's gone on into the song.
Yeah,
we're good to go, man. Sorry.
All right. Yeah. Cool. This is a song. This is called Where You Have Gone. Thank you.
don't wanna know where you are going. I don't wanna know where you have gone. I just wanna be here with you now. On your own.
Thank you.
That was good, man. That was amazing. Man. Thanks for bringing that in and sharing that with us.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so maybe some universal songwriter questions, I guess. Where do you draw inspiration from?
I mean, obviously from listening to music, and I don't know. It's just pretty much random for me.
Nice.
You know, jamming with the band, or usually it's just when I least expect it. I never sit down like planning to write a song, you know.
Yeah.
Sort of just happens. Like even before I was warming up a little bit before coming over here, and I started writing a song that I really like.
There you go. That's nice. And I imagine that you, the more you produce, how long have you been a musician?
Probably since about I think I was 12 or 13 when I first got a guitar. Yeah, my dad got me a guitar. Started taking music lessons around 12 or 13.
Nice. It's cool that you did end up with a instrument that you continued to play. I talked to a lot of different people with experience in band, and they played different instruments and such, but it was this long before they ran into this one or something, and then it really helped them because they could express themselves or whatever.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. And I imagine, you know, the more you write, the more experience you have in life, the more things that'll be revealed to you and that you'll stumble upon and find ways to work with creatively. So that's pretty exciting. And we were talking earlier today about the upcoming show with Otanana Trio and such at Natsuo. Have you checked out, y'all are on that lineup, have you checked out any of the other acts on that lineup?
Yeah, I hadn't heard of any of them. Yeah, I checked them all out. Field Trip, Your Friendly Neighborhood Anarchist, and yeah, Otanana Trio. And yeah, man, I'm excited. It's gonna be a good show.
Yeah, that's it's a pretty diverse show, you know, and I think that's kind of cool. You know, it's all within a realm of sound, but it's pretty diverse. It looks to be a good turnout, and I'm sure people will enjoy y'all's music there. So you wanna share some more live music with us here?
Yeah, sure.
Great. Let's get into something else here. What's the next one that you're gonna play called?
I think I'll play song called Into the Sky.
All right, Into the Sky, KPFT.
I just gotta know where you fall, and I'll come get you. Can I go around all these walls and find my way home, all where I know you? I swear that you and I will be together, even when you go into the sky. I'll be right here with you now and forever, even when you go into the sky. I'll fall. All the people I know and love, I just want to say, I don't know how I got such luck. I'm grateful for this day. Now I swear that you and I will be together, even when you go into the sky. I'll be right here with you now and forever. everything will be okay. And I have my family, and I have my friends, and I have you. Even when you go into the sky, I'll be right here with you now and forever. Even when you go into the sky, I'll fall, I'll fall.
Thank you.
Good stuff. Good stuff, definitely. And if you enjoyed this, you can definitely check it out on the archives at kpft.org to give it another listen. And you can find Shalva online, I'm sure, on Facebook. And yeah. What else do you got there? SoundCloud, Bandcamp?
Yeah, we got SoundCloud, Bandcamp, yeah, Facebook, all that jazz, website.
Nice, nice. So if you enjoyed this music, please get into it, because that's definitely something that we pride ourselves on being able to do, is share good music with friends, and we consider you all our friends. So thanks for tuning in to Freethinker Radio, checking out Shalva Live. Anything you want to talk to an audience about?
I'm real excited for this upcoming show on Thursday. I'm excited for the community.
Yeah, hey man, I'm glad to hear that, and I'm definitely excited for the community myself. I guess we'll another question that I usually ask everyone, and I know Derek wants to get into more news articles and such, but a question I usually ask everyone is, you know, I know that everybody that we talk to is at different stages of their band's development. Yeah. Some bands have been together for over a decade, and some are relatively new and such. But what do you kind of see as like kind of your purpose with your band, and mm-hmm. and you know, what would you like Shalva to be able to do?
Yeah, well, we got a lot of goals. You know, obviously we're just getting started, so you know, we've been just doing the open mics, playing local shows. We're working on getting some t-shirts done,
nice,
some
nice.
Merchandise, some stickers, all that stuff.
Oh, that's great. You know, it gets the word out more, you know.
Yeah.
People find the bands and the and
yeah,
so on.
Yeah, so all that, and then we're trying to yeah, just, I mean, it all starts locally, so we're really trying to get a buzz going in Houston.
What are some of the bands that you've played with that you've really been impressed by? Or at least sort of been impressed by?
Well, we played with this band, they're based out of, I think they're based out of Nashville and Houston, maybe they come back and forth. They're called Anchor North.
Anchor North, huh?
We played with them back in August. They were really cool. We played with a cool band up at Acadia. I think they're based out of Austin. They're called The Imaginary Band.
Oh, interesting name.
They're really cool. There's a local band called Civetta D.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
We haven't played with them yet, but we really, really want to sometime soon.
I could see that. I could see that. Y'all have a fairly complimentary, although different sound. So
yeah,
yeah. That's all awesome. It sounds all positive. It's really great to see that you know, through the lineup changes, y'all are continuing. The songs are beautiful and amazing.
Thank
so
you.
I'm looking forward to that show Thursday as well.
Oh,
so
me too.
Heck yeah. All right. Well. Thanks again for everyone listening in. We're going to get to, I guess, a little bit more news now, and I'll see our guests out, and Derek will hit y'all up with whatever's next. Hey, we're going to hear some music, huh, Derek?
Yeah.
Heck yeah. All right. So y'all enjoy this, and we'll be right back at y'all. All right. More Devil Killing Moth. Good stuff. Wow. I just got loud. Thanks, Derek. My computer's been a little bit insane. And, you know, they got people out there on the phones taking...
Absolutely. Go ahead. Let them know about that. I was just thinking I was out there listening to people try to call in. They got some... They're doing the fundraiser.
The fundraiser, and I'm just going to spend a moment on it because KPFT, we've seen a lot of stations come and go, you know. Strong stations that have come back that aren't as strong as they once were, different things like that. And, you know, now's the time. Now's the time if you want to try to help a station survive, a station, an iconic station that's, you know, been around here for... decades doing this here from the heart of Montrose, getting the words out, been bombed, been shot at, had everything else done to it, gives Freethinker Radio and all these musicians a home, broadcast such programs as, or shows, I should say, because there's no programming, there's just shows here, such as Herman Garcia's Sweet Nightmares, Lisa's... what the heck is that show called? I'm sorry. But there's a ton of shows here. And
well, they're just generally a good... It's a good community voice resource for tons of different content.
Check out the website.
They let us on air.
Yeah, they have us on there. Check out the website. And
that's reason enough to support them.
There's a lot of shows. You can find out, you know, there's a variety of shows. And you can find out other ones that might, you know, you might then get into. But other than that, you can contribute with your monetary donations by calling in. Or you can also go ahead and get that barcode and scan it at Kroger, like we're always talking about. Have you thought of that already? If you have, this is your reminder. Get that barcode, scan that with your card.
Yeah, and you could follow them on social media as well to support them and tune in to the other shows throughout the week.
Invite
90.1 HoustonKPFT.org. We're going to get into some stories. Now, there's quite a bit going on, as usual, but there's I think, a couple of big picture stories that we're going to hit, and we both got a couple of different ones. So we've got 30 minutes here with you, and of course we're always open to taking your calls. If you enjoyed the music you just heard a moment ago in the studio, or if any of the stories we talked about earlier piqued your interest, or maybe you have an event coming up that we forgot to mention or didn't see, you can call in at 713-526-8737. And I know we do have friends listening. I've seen several people posting on Facebook and some new names that I haven't seen. Usually people who I just
like Knoxville now,
people who are tuning in now, you know, so it's cool.
New names,
like, you know, like names that I'm like, oh wow, that person is listening to us on the radio. Shout out to those people.
We need new names. So, you know, please, if you think this show could benefit someone or, you know, might just be entertaining to them, give them an invite to the event. Each week we should have a new event, new guests, created, so we'll try to be more systematic with that. And we do appreciate all the patience, you long-term listeners, you there. We do appreciate all your patience as we continue to evolve. And
absolutely, yeah,
let's get into something.
All right, so one of the things I'd like to talk to you guys about, another story that happened last Wednesday, as the 9/11 story I talked about earlier. This happened right after our show, so we're just catching you up on it. The continuing situation in North Dakota and the fight against the pipeline basically reached a new level of tension on Tuesday and Wednesday, but specifically Wednesday. First, on Tuesday, there was a prayer action where a caravan, a large amount of cars from the reservation, went to some of the areas where the construction is taking place, and they held prayers and held ceremony. And there was the Sami indigenous people of Norway came all the way out to North Dakota, which is really cool. And there was, again, the growing camp, which is reaching out 2,000 to 3,000 people and over 300 tribal nations, unified now out there at Standing Rock. So they're doing their prayer event, and Tuesday everything went fine, but it was also the first appearance of what is known as a Bearcat, those kind of military style vehicles that some of you may have seen on American streets or foreign countries during war. They brought that out, so that was kind of like, oh, okay, we're reaching a new level. Then Wednesday, they showed back up with the Bearcats, and they showed up with another, one's like a tan sort of sand-colored vehicle, the other one's black, and it looks like it has that LRAD sound cannon that we've talked about in past stories, and you may have seen it, major protests, and it just basically is, you know, it puts out a high-frequency sound that hurts your ears, so you run away. They didn't use it, but it looks like that's what is atop this vehicle. And basically the same thing happened. There was two different ceremonies at two different sites of the construction. There was no violence or anything from the protesters. They weren't even, you know, locking themselves to machines or doing paint, you know, spray painting the machines or anything. It was just going to the sites to pray over them. And at first, at one of the sites, there was three airplanes, two helicopters, military vehicles started trying to show up. And when they went to the second site, they were there for about 40 minutes and there was prayers going on. And as they started to leave, all these police vehicles came in really fast and basically surrounded them. And they came out drawing shotguns. The cops were armed with shotguns, military style riot gear coming out. And the water protectors, the protesters out there, whatever you want to call them, I prefer protector. They were yelling, "We're unarmed, we are unarmed," making it very clear, you know, to all these officers and everybody videotaping and listening, "We are unarmed, you guys are coming out with guns, like, nobody has any weapons here." Just, and that's kind of the day we're living in now. You need to, as soon as, let an officer know immediately, "I have no weapons," because the slightest movement, reaching for your ID, reaching for your gum in your pocket,
it's
whatever.
Interesting you bring that up, because when I was talking about the students taking a knee, in addition to their... school superintendent or whatever he was, you know, commending them and defending their rights. That school district is also teaching students how to deal with police class, you know, separate from like civics or anything like that. Like, that's how concerned they are about the issue you're speaking about. Not necessarily the pipeline, but, you know, the militarization of the police.
It's good that, well, I mean, it's unfortunate that that's a situation, but I think it's good, though, that people realize and that there's some sort of thinking of, like, hey, we should arm our communities with knowledge of how to deal with violent police officers or agents of the state. So as they started to try to leave, they were surrounded. 21 arrests were made. Like I said, the cops, the police that were there, and the private security had the MRAPs, mine-resistant ambush-protected vehicles, the Bearcats, what looked like an LRAD. They definitely were dressed for riots, and they made 21 different arrests. That was last Wednesday. Then I'm working on a story right now, and I've seen this reported earlier today. They've actually gained some support now from Congress, 19 members of Congress, mainly Democratic. I think actually probably all Democratic members of Congress wrote a letter to President Obama asking him to withdraw federal permits for the Dakota Access Pipeline, like he previously done with the Keystone Pipeline, and just expressing their support for the Standing Rock Sioux and the Sacred Stone Camp and the Red Warrior Camp. And it also was reported that, according to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, federal officials there, they said that they have no plans to evict the camp there, you know. And basically, they realize they have a situation there. Eileen Williamson, an Army Corps spokeswoman, said, "We don't have the physical ability to go out and evict people. It gives the appearance of not protecting free speech. Our hands are really tied." So, you know, it's the situation is just going to continue to grow. And I mean, I know in the past, Native movements have occupied Alcatraz for 19 months. They've, you know, went to Wounded Knee. So it doesn't seem like this fight is going away anytime soon. And as I said last time, you know, just the concern about how do we make sure that it doesn't end up in violence. You know, the police now are showing that they're willing to come dressed in military-style vehicles with shotguns ready. These weren't non-lethal weapons either. They didn't have those little orange tip things you usually see. You know, it was like these are actual live weapons, live ammunition, and military-style vehicles being used on Native communities here in the United States. So we'll continue to monitor the situation and support. Myself and others will be going to Standing Rock later this month to support how we can. I'm talking with Whitney from Days and Days right now about scheduling a benefit show for the people fighting the pipeline and just some support in that way. So lots of things going on locally if you want to get involved in that. I got a couple more, but what you got, Micah?
Oh, mix it up. Kind of, this is out of the valley down here in Texas. Student interrogated by police without adult consent. Nothing new, right? You know, most of us are pretty aware this is happening, but his father's really upset about it.
You mean I shouldn't trust my little boy with a cop?
It turns out, yeah, that this individual was upset that his 16-year-old daughter was pulled out of class at La Jolla High School and took into a room, interrogated about a car that was keyed 2 weeks ago for, I guess, about an hour or so. A 16-year-old girl with a police officer, no lawyer, et cetera, honestly did not appreciate that in no way caused, was there any adult supervision, nothing. they had her in there by themselves. That's disturbing because nobody notified anybody, the father said. You know, this is something to think about, you know, and like we said, often what we see in one locale goes on in many others. So I wanted to kind of bring some light to that. You know, your kid can't buy cigarettes. Your kid can't go buy you a pack, can't go buy you a 12 pack up at the store. Kids can't do all kinds of things, can't, you know, but they can go ahead and, you know, incriminate themselves, which I'm sure they're really happy. And who knows, we've seen different tactics that have been used to, you know, try to pressure people into confessions and such. So, you know, so not only do you have the police at some schools and guards at others, but you also have, you know, questioning without an attorney present. You know, so yeah, that's at the schools. So if it's like that at the schools, I wonder what it's like elsewhere.
I was just talking with this earlier with a friend about just how important throughout history it has been for totalitarian and sort of fascist controlling regimes to get the you know, the sort of separate the children from the family and from their main source of influence, basically. Because I was thinking about 1984, and I was telling a friend who hasn't read 1984 yet how, oh, in the book, they even have it where the little kids are taught to listen to their parents, and if their parents display any sort of sign of not being patriotic or really nationalistic, jingoistic, whatever, that they should report them. And the kids were like the spies, where the parents were terrified of them because they were just cramming this stuff into the kids' head, kind of like Nazi youth-style thing. Just telling them that, like, oh, Big Brother is taking care of you. You always have to trust Big Brother. But, you know, there's bad people out there. They're traitors. And one of them might even be your parent or your brother or your sister. So make sure you keep them on guard and just have these little minions, like, of the state. So definitely there's a reason they want to have that sort of influence and control over young minds.
Arkansas, a congressman who helped protect citizens' rights to record police was arrested for recording police.
I saw that headline. I didn't read the story, though. Tell us.
They didn't press charges, of course, because, you know, it was one of the club. But thank goodness for this congressman, you know, at least using that power to defend both. He, you know, he was standing up and recording the treatment of a black man who had been put in handcuffs during a traffic stop. And the officer who was there told Representative Walker he had to stop recording or face arrest. Representative Walker said, "Arrest me." Officer Thompson did. Later, police dropped all charges against the congressman.
Wow.
You know, if it wasn't a congressman, they probably would have given him the beat down. Maybe some jailers would have given him beat down. Who knows? I'm not, I mean, you don't know that, but it might have been. It might have been a case.
It is a likelihood. This story here, the Pentagon caught paying a PR firm $540 million to make fake terrorist videos this past week. According to a new joint investigation by the Sunday Times and the Bureau of Investigative Journalism, the Pentagon paid a public relations firm based in the UK over $500 million to make fake terrorist videos in Iraq as part of an enormous propaganda campaign.
Well, I guess when you got all that taxpayer money, well,
you can do all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
And this might lend credibility to the idea. Those who don't really trust the fear of terrorism and think that maybe the government has a hand in promoting false terror narratives in order to keep you afraid. PR firm Bell Pottinger fabricated short TV segments designed to imitate Arabic news networks and fake insurgent videos, which could be used to track the people who watch them, according to a former employee, reports the Bureau. High-ranking U.S. military officials worked with the firm's employee at Baghdad Camp Victory to create anti-terrorism propaganda to imitate the real thing, the Bureau claims. Besides the Pentagon, Bell Pottinger's list of clientele also includes former Chilean director Augusto Pinochet's foundation, Margaret Thatcher, and the government of Saudi Arabia. Bell Pottinger's former chairman, Lord Tim Bell, reportedly confirmed to the Times collaboration on a, quote, covert military operation covered by various secrecy agencies and reported to the CIA, the Pentagon, and the National Security Council. According to the report, the firm was brought to Iraq and began working shortly after the United States first invaded, under the condition that it would portray Al-Qaeda negatively, and then track whoever watched the propaganda. Both the White House and General David Petraeus, then commander of coalition forces in Iraq, signed off on the program. Thus, the president was almost certainly aware of this program's existence. And the Bureau reports, in the first media interview in any Bell Pottinger employee has given about the work for the U.S. military in Iraq, video editor Martin Wells, who no longer works for the company, told the Bureau his time in Camp Victory was, quote, shocking, eye-opening, and life-changing. By tracking U.S. Army contracts, records of federal procurement transactions, reports for the Department of Defense, Officer of Inspector General, corporate records from Bell Pottinger, and more, the Bureau was able to discover the extent of the program. One military contractor who spoke with the outlet to explain the three types of labels given to media operations used in Iraq said, "White is attributed. It says who produced it on the label. Gray is unattributed, and black is falsely attributed. These type of black ops used for tracking who is watching a certain thing were a pretty standard part of the industry toolkit."
Yeah, we all do it, you know.
And he also told the Bureau that, quote, "identified transactions worth $540 million between the Pentagon and Bell Pottinger for information operations and psychological operations on a series of contracts from May 2007 to December 2011. So this is just one company that the Pentagon, the Department of Defense, is working with, one out of probably many more that they partner with to create propaganda films for the purpose of tracking people, for the purpose of pushing various narratives. And, you know, there's definitely skeptics out there of a lot of the war on terror who say, point to some of the videos even of Osama bin Laden, supposing some of these other terrorists that look like, hey, these look very well produced, or some of the ISIS videos, like how do these guys who are supposedly out there just living in the desert have such high quality Hollywood style production and equipment. But yeah, this definitely will lend credibility as well towards what we talked about last week with Operation Mockingbird. And I know we mentioned that briefly, and some of just the influence of the media by government.
For sure, for sure. And especially, you know, I forgot the name of the other act whereby they can give money to scripting of shows that had been made illegal after World War II. They didn't like the way they'd seen it done in other countries, so they didn't want the American people propagandized, so they made a law against it. But then that law was repealed because, you know, they had to take your tax money and put it in, like, I don't know, maybe some shows like, I don't know, just pick one, something like perhaps any show you watch. I really don't know. But, yeah. Yeah, so, you know, you can get this seamless sort of message from the state written into your favorite TV shows. Sons of Anarchy, perhaps. Maybe there's something where there's, what do you call it, like militia. All militias are painted in this light, or, you know.
And a lot of times they work even more directly, like that movie Zero Dark Thirty. There was talk of how the CIA, like, was able to basically help write parts of the script. That's the movie that was about the, you know, supposed capturing of Osama bin Laden,
yeah.
That whole narrative.
While we're talking about movies, I wanted to ask you, Derek, or maybe I just saw it myself, but Do Not Resist, have you seen anything about that documentary? It made the Washington Post just recently.
I saw it shared, but I haven't looked at it. Is it about police violence?
Yeah, I've just discovered it because of the Washington Post article myself, but yeah, it's about police violence, but it doesn't show any beating or anything like that. It goes through and it does it in a different way. Like, you know, you were talking about an MRAP earlier as well, you know, and this is just a little piece from the Washington Post article, for example. Quote, "It's one thing to show an MRAP, a vehicle built for war and a very specific purpose in a very specific type of war, being misused after a small-town police agency obtained it from the Department of Defense. Do Not Resist takes you to the base where those vehicles are stored. A camera trained on the window captures hundreds of MRAPs, rows and rows and rows of them, scrolling by, all destined for a police agency somewhere in America. Meanwhile, an Army specialist explains how the troops use these vehicles get hours and hours of training before they're entrusted to drive the trucks on the battlefield. The Pentagon then gives the trucks to police agencies to use on U.S. streets with no accompanying training at all. Sometimes, specialist says, a police agency will find a body part in one of the trucks. They try to avoid that, but after all, these are machines of war." The film then takes rides with a small town sheriff as he drives his hulking new MRAP through business districts and quiet neighborhoods. That is, once he figures out how to operate it. The most disturbing thing about this scene isn't the truck itself or the striking images of the truck in the town or even the sheriff's statement that it will probably mostly be used for drug raids. The most disturbing thing is that it simply doesn't occur to the sheriff that the footage might be disturbing. He has no problem letting a film crew show his massive contraption built to withstand roadside bombs in a military convoy lumbering through his small town, because the notion that military vehicles aren't appropriate for domestic policy is... or for domestic policing is foreign to him. You know, you get it?
Wow.
Yeah, and it goes on and explains different aspects of this. So I wanted to, you know, get your take on it. If you'd seen it, I haven't seen it. I might have to check it out.
I haven't seen it. I saw an ad for it earlier, but I haven't like looked into it much.
It sounds like it's really trying to get more to like the roots of the problem than the actual, you know, the beatdowns. We cover a lot of the beatdowns, but at the same time, we try to get into the funding and you know what these, you know, things such as the civil asset forfeiture laws and other things that are systematic roots, you know, and maybe actually nourish this problem. So, yeah, get into that if you want to, you know, read a little bit more about that. And that's straight from the Washington Post itself, and it's a pretty in-depth article.
Awesome. I got another couple here. Please do check that out. As we've mentioned, we're covering a lot of news, and we're thankful again to everyone who's tuned in today. And if anyone feels like calling and commenting, 713-526-8737. We still haven't quite heard whether you think that Mr. Rogers has the neighborhood or this neighborhood, but I'm going to go ahead and assume that you guys are from the same universe that I am, and it's the neighborhood.
Let's see if Google's from neighborhood or not.
Google is the current universe, but they also think that it's Berenstain Bears, so I'm just not going to even get into that. So I have one here from The Intercept. Former CIA detainees describe a previously unknown torture tactic. This is a pretty gruesome one, but I think it's important for us to cover these things and
PBS
to recognize
kids.
That these are happening. You know, these type of things. We stood together against the torture action a couple years ago, and we helped organize some national marches around the fact that, hey, guess what? The U.S. government is still torturing people, even if it's not being talked about in the media. It's important for you to be aware.
Hey, man. I just looked it up on pbskids.org.
And?
It's this neighborhood.
It's wrong, I'm telling
by
you.
By Fred M. Rogers. He wrote the song.
Yes, well, he's off. He's off his rocker. Two former CIA captives recently described being threatened with a makeshift electric chair, a previously unreported torture method, while being held in the U.S. government's infamous Salt Pit prison in Afghanistan. In independent interviews with Human Rights Watch in August that were made public on Monday, Ridha al-Najjar, 51, and Lutfi al-Arabi al-Gharasi, 52, described a metal device that had wires with clips that would attach to the fingers and a helmet connected to wires. I saw an electric box, the chair. They said, we will torture you with electricity. Al-Gharasi said he was forced in the chair and connected to the machine, but he was never actually electrocuted. Both men also described various forms of water torture, including having their heads dunked in a bucket of water until they couldn't breathe, waterboarding, and being strapped to a board while submerged face down in a bathtub.
So threatening to electrocute people isn't a violation of, like, decency?
Not in the eyes of these people, but I mean, these are people.
So if I go into a bank and say,
willing,
I'm going to shoot you.
They're willing to put
but
you
I'm not
to
really.
A board and put it upside down. In
it's a fake
bathtub.
Gun. It's a fake gun. What if I had a fake
but
gun,
a real
would
threat.
I get a shot?
It's a real threat. This is the first time that both of these men, who are Tunisian nationals, have spoken about their time in CIA custody. And there's no mention of electric chairs in the unclassified executive summary of the Senate Intelligence Committee's torture report that was released in December 2014. These terrifying accounts of previously unreported CIA torture methods show how little the public still knows about the U.S. torture program, said Laura Pitter, senior National Security Counsel for Human Rights Watch. The release of these two men without the U.S. providing any assistance or redress for their torture and suffering also shows how much the U.S. still needs to do to put the CIA torture program behind them. Both men, being Tunisian citizens, were released and repatriated to their home country last year. Neither was ever charged with a crime, and the U.S. government did not compensate them for their torture or imprisonment for 13 years.
13 years?
13 years, no charge.
But we got $500 million to pay for some propaganda.
They were never charged once. So, I mean, they were held.
Don't turn me down.
Held. And all right. They were held. They were abused. They were detained. You know, obviously, they did not want to be there.
Yeah.
And they're just expected to go home, go back to normal life, forget about it. Whoops, our bad.
Wait,
we weren't actually terrorists.
Something. So let's see. Rudolf Hess, who was like that second in command of Hitler, you know, guy, they kept him in the most he was alone in a prison, basically, in Russia. They guarded him till forever, and they spent all this money to guard all these ex-Nazis as they captured them, you know, because they were such horrible, you know, war crimes, monsters to humanity, killing all these people. But these people, they were captured, right? And they were taken to a prison where they were kept for 13 years by a place that says, you know, due process and all this. And then they're just like, oh, well, you know, we're not going to, like, prove you did anything. We're just going to go ahead and send you back. That's pretty much what you're telling us is happening.
Yep. 13 years gone. Not only just 13 years of your life sitting in a jail cell, 13 years being abused.
13 years of conditioning by these
tortured,
people.
Mental, you know, I'm sure these men developed PTSD, like all, you know, just different types of trauma from that crap.
And who knows? I don't want to say maybe they were experimenting on. I'm just joking. But seriously,
you never know what goes on.
You never know what goes on. When you see these things later that they admit to, you never know what's going on. And the fact of the matter is, these could have been some kind of cruel psychological experiments to see breaking conditions and all kinds of stuff.
So let me read this little section here, and we'll move on from this report. CIA interrogators quoted in the declassified executive summary of the Senate report, which we did see, that's the declassified version, describes the prison as, quote, a dungeon where detainees cowered when interrogators entered their cells, looking like a, quote, dog that had been kenneled. Although the declassified summary does not mention electric shocks or an electric chair, it is possible that the full report, which contains a detailed account of each detainee's interrogation, does. Unfortunately, it remains classified by the Obama administration.
Yeah.
So good luck finding out what they're really doing. That's, you know, when you joke about maybe they were experimenting on, the truth is we don't know, because we know some things that have been leaked from 50 years ago that they were already experimenting on people.
I'd say the fact of the matter is they were experimenting on.
I mean, I've considered
basically things were done to them and records were kept. You know, you could either use that or not.
One other one I do want to mention, I think is kind of important. This I teased this earlier a little bit about related to the election and Julian Assange of WikiLeaks discussing, you know, that he tweeted earlier, he's like, Hillary Clinton goes down next Wednesday or something like that. And they had talked, he for months he said, we have some footage, you know, some documents that would harm her campaign.
Some of those things.
He said that before. So there was an announcement last week where basically people were expecting him to come to the balcony of the Ecuadorian embassy in London, which is where he's been living for the last 5 years, that he's been, you know, pursued by the U.S. government and also by the Swedish government, because in that time, charges, some say trumped up, charges came about alleging that he sexually assaulted somebody, and they're trying to extradite him. So he stays in the embassy and occasionally comes out to give speeches on the balcony. He was supposed to give a presentation and make an announcement on the balcony on Tuesday. But apparently that it will change now. WikiLeaks has confirmed that it was delayed. Originally they were saying they had specific information regarding his safety, Assange's safety. And I mentioned this to Mike earlier. A couple weeks ago it got reported, I'm not sure if you guys saw this, but it was reported that a man was arrested while trying to climb into the balcony where Julian Assange usually speaks, and I guess assuming that's where he was at. He was arrested and apprehended. Now, there's plenty of people in the United States who have joked about wanting to harm Julian Assange, and just like with Edward Snowden and Chelsea Manning, they're called traitors, or they accuse them of working with the Russians or being spies or whatever, because they reveal, you know, important information and also sometimes embarrassing information about these officials and the way they talk about each other, the way they talk about the people. And it's valuable to know. They're doing, I think, an interesting service. Now, whether or not you think it's true journalism, I think, is a different discussion, but it cannot be denied that Julian Assange's life probably is in danger in some way. And he has said that he had some information that will harm Hillary Clinton. And now that announcement, though, has been moved. Tomorrow's press conference in Berlin proceeds. They tweeted earlier today, London speech by Julian Assange has been moved to Berlin due to specific information. And that they put the hashtag WikiLeaks10. I'm not sure what that means, but we'll find out, I guess. And Julian Assange, as I said, has been living in the Ecuadorian embassy for the last 5 years, and we'll have to wait and see what the exact announcement is, but it could be big, something big. And I do want to say, these leaks that WikiLeaks has been providing have been coming through a website called DC Leaks that the Clinton campaign and the U.S. government has accused Russia of being involved in. Even though they haven't been able to prove it, they've been saying, oh, we believe there's Russian connection. And also at the same time, you have, you know, people accusing Donald Trump of being connected to the Russians. So there's sort of this, oh, Donald Trump's buddy Putin's interfering with the U.S. election by leaking documents that are going to be harmful to Hillary Clinton to WikiLeaks. But I don't buy that. Some people also suspect that WikiLeaks' true source was a man by the name of Seth Rich, who worked for the Democratic National Committee. He's a DNC staffer who died in July, apparently from a robbery. He was shot and killed. But some people suspect that he was actually the source for the WikiLeaks leaks that have been coming out related to the Democratic National Committee. And then randomly that guy dies. He was fired, and then
Is he on that list that you were talking about, the Clinton list?
That's what some people believe. Yeah, I was saying, yeah, the Clinton body count that some people talk about. Some people do believe that Seth Rich was involved with that, but according to the official reports, it was just a robbery gone wrong, and they ended up killing him, unfortunately. But yeah, just some interesting backstory. So look out for that tomorrow, and we'll tell you what happened. We'll talk about that next week. But definitely that's going to be something big happening tomorrow. Conference in Berlin from WikiLeaks, making some announcement, something about Hillary Clinton, and hopefully releasing some new documents, and we'll see how things go and how that plays out. One other interesting story, and then we're going to get out of here pretty soon, but this is interesting that you should look into. Like, Micah's insisting on playing Mr. Rogers' song. Can you hear it?
I just couldn't help it. No, it's all right.
Okay.
I stopped.
Well,
I just couldn't help myself.
I want to cover this last one before we wrap up. Guys, we just got like a couple minutes with you real quick, but this is something to look into. Most people are not aware or have never heard of ICANN, the Internet Corporation for the Sign Names and Numbers, which manages domain names and the assignment of ISPs, Internet Service Provider numbers, under a contract with the U.S. Department of Commerce. Yes, the Internet is decentralized, but there are institutions and bureaucracies behind it. And that nonprofit, ICANN, has passed now, the control of ICANN has passed from the U.S. government to a, quote, global multi-stakeholder community Saturday after a federal judge refused Texas's 11th hour request to block the transfer. So now the control of this particular aspect of the internet goes to from the United States Department of Commerce to an international organization aboard. And some people say this is the beginning of, you know, the United Nations or international takeover of the internet infrastructure. Could be. I don't know, but keep your eyes on it. I'm going to read more into it myself, but definitely look up ICANN if you don't know much about them. It's interesting to understand how the actual mechanisms of the internet work. So check that out.
Yeah, we actually covered that a little while back before it happened, talking about it was going to happen.
Yeah, it's happened.
Yeah, Army's sending more troops and resources to Africa, just so you know that, too.
They're working. I saw one reported last week as we fade out here. They are working on building a massive drone base out of Africa as well, multiple drone bases. So that's the continued colonization of Africa. And we said that, we've been talking about that for years, that they've been building. I think 2 years ago they announced there was going to be 60 new military bases built across Africa. Unfortunately, the United States empire is trying to spread, but empires will spread themselves thin, and eventually, guess what? They crumble. And that's where free people can come in and build something better. We appreciate you guys tuning in today to our show and listening to our rant and rave. And thank you again to our musical guest.
For sure. Thank you, Connor. And again, thank you everyone who tuned in. And you are a wonderful, powerful person. And we appreciate it when you exercise that.
Yeah, thank you guys for everything. We're going to close out with another song from True Universal. I think we may have played this one, but they're going to be coming down. I put on the for the community thing that they're from New York. They're actually from LA, so we'll have to fix that. But thank you to
whole different world.
To everybody who's coming to For the Community. Be sure to check out their set, and we'll be back next Monday. You are powerful, you are beautiful, you are free.
Peace.
What's right for me, as long as I'm peaceful, but deceitful people confuse.